Stanford University.
Good evening. Welcome to tonight's Café Scientifique at Stanford Blood Center. My name is Kevin O'Neill in the Marketing and Communications Department. Stanford Blood Center is part of the pathology department within the Stanford School of Medicine. It is the primary supplier of blood products to Stanford Medical Center, which is the second largest user of blood products in our nation, as well as to four other major hospitals in our community. Of the 85 blood centers in the United States, two are community blood product providers and have a blood research mission, Stanford Blood Center being one of them. Our success would not have been possible without our many faithful blood donors, many of whom are here this evening. Thank you all. This evening, we are privileged to have as our speaker Dr. Daryn Reicherter. He is a clinical associate professor in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Science at the Stanford University School of Medicine. Dr. Reicherter is a graduate of UC Santa Cruz and the New York Medical College School of Medicine. He did his internship and residency training at Stanford. Dr. Reicherter is involved with the movement for promotion of trauma, mental health, and human rights issues internationally. He works locally with refugee survivors from around the world. Please welcome Dr. Daryn Reicherter.
Thanks. Thank you. Well, thank you. Thank you for coming out. So a couple of things you'll have to bear with me tonight. I never use PowerPoint, and tonight I'm going to use PowerPoint. So if I'm fumbling over an age-old technology, I apologize for that. I actually usually use a chalkboard when I teach at Stanford, and I've been told that that's like a time machine going back in time, which is fine with me. But today I'm going to use PowerPoint because I think it actually lends well to the talk that I'm going to give. I also want to say before I start and introduce myself a little bit that this is a hard talk to give for a general audience. This is a talk that I'm usually giving to human rights professionals, human rights attorneys, or psychiatry residents who are very familiar with violence, trauma. So I tried to make it suitable because some of the themes are very heavy. And I must pre-apologize if I touch on some nerves, because some of the things that I do talk about are pretty grave. But I tried to make it so that it's not like that. I tried to make it really a talk that's an inspiring one, because some of the things that have come in the last 6 months of my career have been very inspiring and very hopeful. So I tried to make this lecture that way too. So piggybacking on what he said, so I do, I am faculty at Stanford, and through my faculty appointment, I have a lot of positions in the community where I'm able to work with refugee survivors. I was the board president for Survivors International in San Francisco for 5 years. I've worked at the Center for Survivors of Torture in San Jose through Stanford for about 3 years, but not through Stanford for more like 10 years. And I also work with the Cambodian specific trauma mental health program in San Jose, California. I've worked there for about 14 years. And in all of those programs, I'm seeing survivors of human rights violations that are now in the United States but have lived through terrible things in other places. And then I've also worked internationally. So doing that work gets you very inspired to do a lot of advocacy work and actually end up traveling. And I've been in places, post-disaster places, Indonesia after the tsunami. I was in Haiti after the earthquake, doing advocacy for mental health and projects for people that were traumatized in those situations. But I think the work that I'm the most passionate about now is really work about political violence and the trauma mental health that results from that. And so for about 7 or 8 years, I've been going back and forth between here and Cambodia and very much involved with the survivor story in Cambodia. And so you're going to hear a lot about that tonight. I've become a consultant to a program in Cambodia called the Documentation Center of Cambodia, which people here may or may not have heard of. It was formerly called the Yale Genocide Project, and then it became the Documentation Center of Cambodia. And that's the way I thought I'd sort of start, is by sort of, so what? So why why would a psychiatrist become a consultant to a documentation center rather than a consultant to, you know, a mental health program or the Department of Mental Health or some program that actually treats survivors? And the reason why I became involved with the program called the Documentation Center is because they have a great big microphone. They have a great big loudspeaker that can get the message out there. Whereas if I'm working with some of the local agencies that treat mental health, I'm limited by how many individuals I can see or by how many clinicians I can train or talk to. Whereas through the Documentation Center, you can be an advocate for programmatic change, stigma reduction, big changes. And specifically, the Documentation Center of Cambodia was involved with the Khmer Rouge Tribunal, the prosecution process to hold the Khmer Rouge accountable for human rights violations. So the Documentation Center basically created the evidence that was used in that legal process. And I'm going to talk a lot about that today. So let me back up. I told you just now that I've been working in San Jose for about 14 years with Cambodian patients. So let me start by saying that I have a friend in Cambodia by the name of Sophanie, and she's my, for 14 years, she's been my translator, and she's a paraprofessional who works in mental health. And I'll even back up and tell you that, so Sophanie was a dancer in Cambodia. And it says there under the illustration, Sophanie was a dancer in Cambodia. She learned the ancient ways of dancing handed down from generation to generation for centuries. She's a real person. She's my friend and again, longtime colleague, very involved in human rights movement. When she grew up, she taught dance to little girls. Also true, she was a teacher of dance in Cambodia before Pol Pot. So now here comes the part that gets we're already getting into the grim part. So she's also a survivor of genocide, and I'm not going to talk about the specifics of what happened to her, but I am going to say that she's one of many survivors of the Pol Pot genocide in Cambodia, where at least 1.7 million, but probably more than 2 million people were killed in genocide. And you can imagine the survivors then also were survivors of human rights violations, starvation, torture, some of the most grave human rights consequences in our world's history, or at least in the last century. And the effects of on psychology in this population is still seen today, right? So that's what we have in our population in San Jose, is a lot of the survivors who came over. These are victims from Tuol Sleng prison in Cambodia. This is the most striking one I've ever seen because it's the only person that was holding a baby when the picture was taken. So my friend became a refugee. Sophanie escaped Cambodia, and her survivor story is actually amazing. I'm not going to tell it tonight because that's a whole hour-long lecture just right there. And so the illustration says, lost and alone, Sophanie was left with nothing but her shadow. The Khmer Rouge turned Cambodia into a shadow land, and Sophanie was forced to move far away, which is true. She left, she escaped to Thailand, where there was huge refugee camps on the Thai-Cambodia border. And then a lot of the refugees were actually able to move from Thailand to other parts of the world, and namely the United States, some in San Jose, California, some in Stockton, California, a big Cambodian population in Long Beach, California. And so the illustration, under the illustration, says, many years later, on the other side of the world, Sophanie tried to heal the wounds left by these bad people. Even though she had escaped the Khmer Rouge, she felt as though she was still a shadow. When she noticed the Cambodian children growing up in America and they did not know the dance of her lost home, she was sad. It was as if the children were going up as shadows too. True story. She did that. She came over here and noticed that. She became a mental health specialist, and that's how I became acquainted with her. Our population of Cambodians here are generally very poorly acculturated. Many of them are still monolingual Cambodian speakers after many years of living in this country. Many of them moved to this country in the 1980s, still do not speak a word of English. And the future generations after them speak very few words of Khmer. So parents can have a hard time talking to their kids in some cases. So What's a psychiatrist doing talking about this stuff? Well, the consequences of these human rights violations in instances like that have amazing consequences for human psychology. And when I say that, let me just get kind of a show of hands in this audience. Is that a surprising idea to anybody, or is it very intuitive? I mean, how many people here would sort of say, yeah, that's very obvious that that would have, right? I mean, people are kind of shaking their heads. And I think that's true, too. And so it is, in fact, very accurate. I mean, the severity, intensity, duration of war crimes, crimes against humanity, human rights violations will predict for bad mental health outcomes. And so what do we actually see? Well, when it comes to actually looking at patients who have been survivors of these kinds of things, we see basic psychiatric diagnoses that Western psychiatrists think about, and we categorize them in a book called the DSM, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Psychiatry. And we're looking at disorders like anxiety disorders, so having panic attacks, having terrible anxiety throughout the day, not being able to sleep at night. The classic one that everybody thinks about with regard to war and violence would be post-traumatic stress disorder. I think most people have probably heard of that. Also, other kinds of disorders that psychiatrists think about, including mood disorders like major depressive disorder. Not shocking, right, to hear that. Somatoform disorders are disorders where people are experiencing physical symptoms that are really mostly psychogenic symptoms. In other words, as a result of the trauma, you might have like terrible pain that's not better explained by a physical condition. And then we see a lot of substance use disorders. We were just talking about some of the work that I did at the VA before I started working with refugees, and I worked at the National Center for PTSD with the veterans in the Palo Alto and Menlo Park VA system. I mean, a lot of the times what you'd end up seeing is really the reason that the gentleman would come in would be because of a substance use disorder, and then if you rewind time and find out that they've basically had an alcohol problem since the Vietnam conflict. And after they stopped using alcohol, then PTSD was really identified as the primary problem. So I think an important point is that you know, these aren't the usual. So in other words, if somebody is in a car accident, even if it's pretty severe, we don't automatically assume from the standpoint of mental health that they would go on to develop a mental health disorder. In fact, most people do not. Most people recover without developing a psychiatric disorder. They might have some psychological symptoms. They might be anxious for a few days or even weeks, but most of these things resolve. And so I think it's a good point for me to make at this point in the talk that the kinds of human rights violations that we're talking about, the severity of the trauma that we're usually talking about, is so heightened that it's predictable that people would in fact go on to develop mental health disorders, which is not usual, right? But in Pol Pot's Cambodia, nothing was usual, right? So in fact, many of the survivors that I end up seeing do indeed have a mental health disorder. Obviously, that's why they would be referred to one of the programs that I'm working in. Obviously, that's why they would be referred to a psychiatrist. So there is sort of a screen there that, you know, we're really seeing refugees who are survivors who also have a mental health disorder. Having said that, though, let's talk about PTSD. So I think everyone's heard of that, right? Post-traumatic stress disorder. It's in the news, and it's a concept that psychiatrists talk about. And basically what it is psychiatrists think about syndromes a lot, right? So multiple symptoms in the realm of psychiatry, psychology, that sort of go together to define a disorder, right? In the context of post-traumatic stress disorder, the symptoms that we're talking about are the ones that I listed below. So I didn't put the whole thing from the DSM, which is several pages long, but basically what we're looking at is people who have intrusive memories of a traumatic experience. Right? So that would include nightmares all night long, replaying the event in your head during the day, you know, your cognition goes to the traumatic event and you're unable to sort of move forward with your thoughts. You're always drawn back to your traumatic events. You're thinking about it all the time, even when you don't want to. And then, you know, another example of an intrusive memory is the one that we see in the Hollywood movies where people have flashbacks, where they actually sort of are transformed into a dreamlike state where they're really sort of re-experiencing the traumatic experience. So actually relatively rare compared with the other symptoms there. The other thing that that our diagnostic manual asks us to look for is avoidance symptoms. So people that have been exposed to traumatic experience and then they try to avoid anything that might remind them of the traumatic experience. So back to my car accident example, maybe you know someone's afraid to get back in a car. I actually did have a patient, not a refugee patient, but a patient who really took 6 months or longer to get back in a car after a terrible accident. You know, understandable, but that would be an example of an avoidance symptom. Or trying to, for my Khmer patients, a lot of them are trying to avoid any news about the Khmer Rouge tribunal because they don't want to hear about it. I'd consider that an avoidance symptom. And then again, the last one being hyper-arousal, or really sort of physical anxiety symptoms. Sleeplessness, insomnia, panic attacks, or what we call hyper-startleability. Someone comes up, makes a loud noise, and a person who has post-traumatic stress disorder really might go into a full panic attack from a car horn or a loud noise, whereas we might be startled for a moment and get reconstitute quickly. A very, very important point that I want to use with this slide is that post-traumatic stress disorder is one of the very few disorders in all of psychiatry that requires a cause, right? Trauma. Most of the other disorders that we look at, major depressive disorder, other disorders that psychiatrists think about, schizophrenia even, there's no, involved in that diagnosis is not a necessary cause, and in this one it is. And that's going to become an important point for the work that I'm doing. Because in many of the cases that I'm talking about where I'm working with survivors of torture, the cause, of course, is torture, but the cause is also a crime. So that's different from a lot of other mental health phenomena that we see. And another important point is the criterion A up here is a risk factor for criterion B, C, and D, right? So the worse the A is, the more likely you are to see B, C, and D. Makes sense. But again, it'll factor into the bigger picture later. You know, unfortunately, really, some of the systems of human rights violations that are out there, including torture and other dignity crimes, are really designed almost to be the traumatic experience that would create the other criterion. In other words, the goal of torture is often to create somebody who has post-traumatic stress disorder, in fact. Another important point that I bring up at this point while that slides up behind me is that there's cultural differences in the way that people express themselves in psychiatry. It's actually one of the reasons why I was very interested in working with other populations and refugees, is because I'm very fascinated by the anthropology of the difference between how somebody's psychology might look if they're from Cambodia as compared with somebody's psychology who's from California, as compared with somebody's psychology who is from the Congo. And I write about the differences between cultures and how they express. I'm going to teach a class at Stanford in the spring quarter that's only about how different presentations occur in psychiatry. One of the things that's curious and interesting about PTSD is that there are a lot of differences, but the bottom line is that these things that are on this board seem to be preserved. And it's a pretty good marker, and you can really kind of use these things to look at trauma outcomes in different populations of different cultures and different languages. And it holds up pretty well. Mostly, I think, because these things are pretty biological. So treatment for PTSD. Well, there's a lot of different kinds of treatment for PTSD. We think about it in the West as, you know, post-traumatic stress disorder or disorders of trauma. Well, they go back to Sigmund Freud, right? And that was one of his ideas that he could use talk therapy for the treatment of trauma-related anxiety disorders and trauma-related psychology. And we still do. We do use psychotherapy to treat PTSD. We use group psychotherapy. At the VA, they use group psychotherapy a lot. Individual psychotherapy from a therapist with a single patient. In the programs that I'm involved with, we were talking beforehand, a lot of the patients that I'm seeing, you know, it's pretty raw, right? Where they're pretty recently immigrated to this country and their symptoms are pretty bad. And so a lot of times they're not really ready to do anything that I would think about as like a Western version of process psychotherapy. And so a lot of times they're doing something that's a little bit more like very basic behavioral therapy, like learning how to do a relaxation technique where they can just stop a panic attack from coming on. Or, you know, basically learning how to go to the grocery store without having so much anxiety that they have to run out of the grocery store. The patients that we're getting in the clinics that I work are, they're not really ready for some of the more advanced therapies. People need to be a little bit farther out of the traumatic event before they can. But what about my Cambodian patients that I see down there? They moved over here in the 1980s. Well, there's a little bit of a cultural bias about what psychotherapy is or how to do it. And so, for instance, we have a psychotherapy group for our Cambodian patients that's run at the temple, where they actually come and work with a Buddhist monk who has training in mental health, and he teaches them relaxation techniques that are basically Eastern meditation techniques that are related to his brand of Buddhism. But from my standpoint as a psychiatrist, they're basically behavioral techniques for relaxation, right? So they go hand in hand. So we actually have a monk who's working with a therapist, and these are conducted in Khmer. But from my standpoint, they're psychotherapy. From his standpoint, they're spirituality. And the patients get better, which is the most important part, right? So, storytelling and testimonial therapy. This is something that was done in Cambodia in the court process. It's well known to Western psychiatrists, sort of going through and replaying the narrative of the trauma, the event that happened to you. Changing the way your thoughts are about that narrative can be very restorative and helpful with actually treating symptoms of PTSD, and maybe better said, not necessarily treating the symptoms of PTSD, but moving past the place in your life where you're sort of stuck in that trauma, or at least rearranging the way that traumatic experience is thought about by the patient. They did that with the victim witnesses in the extraordinary chambers of criminal court in Cambodia, the Khmer Rouge Tribunal, and actually saw some pretty successful therapy, basically by having them re-narrate the story of what happened to them, reconstruct it 35 years after the event. And then what about psychiatric medication? So I'm an MD, psychiatrist, and so one of the things that I end up doing a lot is using psychiatric medication with patients. A lot of the therapy in the clinics that I run is actually done by people who speak the language of the individual who I'm seeing. I'd say 85, 90% of the patients that I see do not speak a language that I speak, right? I'm an English speaker only, and some people have said, well, you should at least learn Spanish. Well, we actually don't have any Spanish-speaking patients in that clinic. And then somebody said, well, you should learn Khmer then. And I was like, well, it's going to be a little bit of a challenge. To be honest with you, if I had known I would be working so long with Cambodians, I might have tried to learn language as well. And I've picked up some here and there. But the bottom line is that I do assessments and treatment with a translator all the time. And it's because we have so many different language groups in that clinic. So many different Asian languages, African languages, and European languages. I would say in any given day, I'm seeing at least 7 different languages. And in the time that I've been there, I've seen languages that I didn't know were languages before, and very hard, in fact, to find a broker of that language. What we try to do is meet the needs of the patients, and so if we're getting an influx of folks from Syria and Iraq, right, we need Arabic speakers, and so we actually have Arabic speakers in that clinic, and we have Farsi speakers in that clinic. We've had for a long time the Khmer speakers and Vietnamese speakers. But then every once in a while, you will get a patient from a place that we don't have that language covered in our clinic. And we had an Eritrean patient. We just don't have a clinician that speaks the language, so we had to get it through a language line. But for that reason, and for the reason that I'm an MD, I end up using a lot of medication. That's sort of my role in the clinic, is to be the medication consultant. And I must say, it's the easiest part of the clinic, I think, because really the medication management for patients with PTSD is pretty straightforward. We're using usually antidepressant medications, and those are pretty straightforward and easy to use. They're easy to prescribe, and they're also pretty easy to take. And the better news is that they work pretty well. Now, I'm not going to say that any of these treatments necessarily cure chronic PTSD, right? Especially in patients that have had it for so long. So when I come onto that clinic and I'm working with patients who have had these symptoms and they're as bad as they were in 1985, and I'm seeing them in 2005 or now almost 2015, right? It's very difficult to treat them, and one of the things that we really have to be clear about is our goals for treatment, like how far can we really get them with our program? But then again, many of our patients are suffering a lot, so getting them a little bit of the way is pretty good. So justice, what about justice as treatment? Well, Stanford asked, can serving justice cure PTSD? They asked me that in 2011. That's actually the real Sophonie Bay. I'm sorry that picture's not as clear. The answer is no. I don't think that justice cures PTSD. I think it's the wrong question, though. I think that the justice process can be very, very important for the mental health of survivors, and knowing that something's been done about a human rights crime can be very helpful in more the existential reality of a trauma survivor or a post-conflict survivor. But I wouldn't say that justice can cure PTSD, right? So what about other interventions? I talked about the meditation groups, that's one. I think every individual has a different way of dealing with being a victim of a human rights violation. I think that some people develop symptoms of post-traumatic stress disorder, but each different person has a slightly different way of what's going to be the most appropriate thing for them. And then I think there's a very important cultural biases and beliefs about what they would even consider trying or consider useful as treatment for PTSD. For Sophonie, the justice process was part of that voyage and part of really thinking about treating PTSD, but also this issue of preserving some of the culture that she was used to, and bringing it back to life in the United States. And so it says that there. So she remembered the dance that was forced into hiding. She remembered how to move her hands and arms. She remembered how to look like the stone reliefs on the walls and temples. Dancing again made her feel happy and strong. The energy of the dance shone light into the shadows. And you see that's San Francisco, so she's here now. And then I love what the illustrator did. They made the reflection of the Angkor Wat temple into the San Francisco Bay. So I've said some things about my work here in San Jose and working with survivors. So I kind of get to the newer work. So if we think about PTSD and the legal process in these human rights cases, and back to that slide that I was talking about, where trauma in the DSM is not defined as a crime. It can be anything, right? You can get struck by lightning and we could call that trauma. You can get hit in a car accident or in a natural disaster, whatever. A traumatic event that's so severe that it is life-threatening, though, right? Well, in the cases that we're talking about, I can switch that out a bit and say that the trauma is almost always, in fact, it is always, in every case that I see, a crime. right? Because by virtue of the fact that I'm seeing survivors of human rights violations and torture, every time it's a crime. And then if you think about that crime multiplied or applied to a population of people, so we're usually talking about massive movements of refugees that end up here in California, but only because a crime was applied to them as a people. So criterion A of PTSD applied to tens of thousands of people at a time, usually by an identifiable perpetrator. Then you start thinking about trauma as a damage in a legal case. Right? So in other words, the pathology that is the outcome of a crime is really something that you have rights about, because we have human rights, and that could be considered a damage in a case. And in individual court cases, it is thought about that way. Right? If you sue somebody and you have psychological damage, it'll get brought up in that case. And in individual cases, it's often looked at that way. But in some of these bigger cases, it's really not thought about that way. If you think about the violence as a risk factor, then it makes a lot of sense, right? So in post-conflict societies, the risk for having PTSD would be much, much, much higher than it would be in a not post-conflict society, right? Makes perfect sense. Well, so how do we measure that? Well, psychiatrists measure those things all the time, right? Usually we're measuring them with individuals. So people come in my clinic and I do a post-PTSD rating scale with them. Well, we use similar things when we do population studies. So like they're doing them right now in the refugee camps that are in Jordan and people coming out of Syria into Jordan, and they're doing the same PTSD studies that I do on individuals here on populations of people, thousands of people. And then they get them published in the New England Journal of Medicine and JAMA and the International Journal of Traumatic Stress. So it's done all the time, and that is what we consider sort of the science of the day for how to measure this, right? So here's a slide that says something that I think is very intuitive, right? PTSD prevalence rates are higher in post-conflict societies. Well, sure, right? Because they have the risk factor. And then all those other mental health disorders that we talked about that are related to trauma and violence also seen at higher rates in post-conflict societies. No surprise either. When I show this slide to my psychiatry residents, they say, why are you showing us this slide? This is something we knew a long time ago, right? The thing that is not always known to everybody is that the difference is marked. It's not minor. It's not a statistical variation. It's a huge exponential difference between a population like the folks that are coming out of Syria and, say, if we went to Marin County and interviewed a general population. It's marked, and it's very easy and pretty accurately measured. So we did it in Cambodia. This is a book that I edited. It came out in 2011. And it was a book basically about the mental health status of a country. So we looked at the cultural differences between PTSD in Cambodia and PTSD in our DSM, or in the American Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Psychiatry, and applied that to Cambodia. And let me just be honest with you, I didn't do that. I collected data that people had been doing and surveys that people had been doing for decades on Cambodian people in the United States, and better, Cambodian people in Cambodia, right? And there's a mountain of data. And so for this book, we actually contacted and were in touch with folks that had actually created the original data, but we also just synthesized all the data that was available. And no surprise, what we found was that the statistics were pretty remarkable, showing that folks who had been survivors of Pol Pot and the Khmer Rouge had terrible mental health outcomes, okay? The book was initially intended basically to be an advocacy piece for for improvements in the public mental health system in Cambodia. In that regard, I must say the book was something of a failure. I don't think we've really changed the public mental health opinion there. But the interesting thing that actually happened with this book was that The group that was more impressed with it and thought it was very interesting was the prosecutors. The prosecutors who were looking at the Cameroon tribunal and had finally, in this decade, arrested some of the upper brass from the Khmer Rouge. So I don't know, this is something that I'll take a quick little tangent. The Khmer Rouge Tribunal is something that should have happened a long, long time ago, but never did. The United Nations finally backed a formal criminal prosecution of the Khmer Rouge, and that only started in about 2008. This trial is happening right now in Cambodia. They've tried case one, and that was a guilty verdict, and case two is actually still in process. I'll talk a little bit more about case two. But basically, the prosecutors thought, wow, look at all this evidence that these psychiatrists created here, or didn't create, found, and synthesized for us. We can admit this as evidence in this tribunal and bring it up as a very real issue before the court, and so they did. The civil party attorneys used the book and the statistics in the damages hearing. So when the judges were hearing about, so what? So all this stuff happened. What is the consequence? What's the outcome? That's when they brought up this book. Let me see what my next slide is here. Yeah, so the things that we already sort of talked about, right? The things that are obvious. Very, very high rates of PTSD associated with the Khmer Rouge and presented as damages. And this had not really been done before, right? The concept of suffering always involved with these human rights cases in these tribunals. Always involved, but never sort of formally brought up as a scientific idea or a epidemiologic reality. Right, so this was breaking ground for psychiatry, and they're very good for the prosecutor, not very good for the defense attorneys. So, we went to Cambodia. This is Sophanie actually testifying in Cambodia as an American mental health professional, and so she had the honor of, I think, being the first person to ever testify about. As an expert witness, and also at the same time talk about her own personal experience of surviving the Pol Pot genocide. She was able to talk about our program in San Jose and what refugee Cambodians are like, how their mental health pathology is like. More important, she was able to talk about her own experience and her survival of the evacuation of Phnom Penh and her subsequent treatment in Cambodia. They also heard testimony from a colleague of mine who lives in Cambodia, Khmer psychiatrist, who is one of the chapter authors in the book and collected much of that data. So he was able to speak in his own language and talk about the experience of being the premier trauma psychiatrist in the country, the Kingdom of Cambodia. So that we were kind of done. I mean, we thought this is thrilling. We actually were able to contribute this new piece of evidence, this new very real part of what we think is the justice process. And we were very excited that this had been considered. Well, the court asked, what about reparations? Is there a factor for mental health in the reparations of these cases? And so we were able to sort of say, yeah. Really, the court should consider improving access to mental health as reparations for court. So, August, the verdict came, and the Khmer Rouge upper brass was found guilty of crimes against humanity, which is not a surprise. The things that were surprising to me was that the judge's decision actually took very seriously the mental health part, right? And so in their judgment, they actually commented on the idea that part of the reason why they were convicted of crimes against humanity is because of the psychiatric outcomes that the crimes caused in the first place, which was our point. But we didn't think the judges would be that excited about it. So that was a thrilling event to sort of have them actually say that part of their decision is based on that. But maybe more thrilling was that they actually endorsed our recommendations for improved mental health. And they actually granted two projects in mental health to the tune of $1 million per project. Now, here in Silicon Valley, $2 million doesn't really buy you a piece of property, right? But in Cambodia, consider that the whole mental health budget, not for trauma, but for everything, is about $40,000 a year, right? And so for them to acknowledge this and give $2 million to separate, $1 million to two separate projects was a real breakthrough for mental health in Cambodia. Now, when I was asked to do this talk, I was actually in Europe for something quite related to this. We had already been so excited that these things were being considered that we said, you know, if this is a theme, then is Cambodia unique? Well, sure, it's unique in a certain way. But in the fact that these risk factors are present in these crimes, and that we expect to see exaggerated numbers in the survivors of these crimes, Cambodia is not that unique from other human rights violations, right? So this project, we wanted to sort of see how the United Nations felt about these ideas as a general idea rather than as a singular idea in Cambodia. So The Hague is sort of the United Nations center for thinking about world justice and particularly criminal tribunals and international criminal issues. So I'm getting ahead of my slides. Very high rates of PTSD. So is it going to be useful in general in criminal cases? So the idea is maybe. So I'm going to talk about that later. So we took this idea to this group, the International Criminal Court, centered in The Hague. There are several different tribunals in the world right now, right? The International Criminal Court is the United Nations idea for moving forward with the general concept of criminal prosecution of human rights crimes. But there's also several others that I was able to visit, including the Tribunal for Former Yugoslavia and the Tribunal for Lebanon. There's several others in the world, but the International Criminal Court is basically where the prosecutors are thinking about the ideas for how to do these things in the future. And they were quite interested in my idea because from their perspective, this is good data and good evidence. And it's basically coming from a pretty objective place. It's not something that's created or found by their investigators. It's rather found in science journals that are already published often, right? So they were very excited about this concept. So what do they do? So just to give you an idea of what the International Criminal Court is thinking about, I put in the slide some of the places they're sort of thinking about right now, right? And so I was asked before, but somebody was asking about Syria. So Iraq and Syria are areas that they're looking, because that's an issue in the news right now. What that means by preliminary examination is that means that there are places that the International Criminal Court is thinking that an investigation is probably necessary. Places that are under investigation. Well, again, you're seeing some names of countries that we know are notorious for former human rights violations or ongoing human rights violations. And I'm not sure how much people are aware of the different violations in the different places that are listed there. But for instance, Darfur is on there. The Congo is on there. These are places that are being investigated now and are likely to result in prosecutions. If you look at the International Criminal Court's website, there's actually warrants written for some of the folks in these countries now. So it's an investigation, and then they actually issue an arrest warrant. And it's striking how that arrest warrant can be taken, because sometimes people are in the middle of a conflict situation, and they say, yeah, come and get me. You know, I've got a tank here, I got a machine gun, come on down. Well, the International Criminal Court is a United Nations function. And I must say, the Khmer Rouge were quite shocked when the police showed up at their door and arrested them. In fact, the comment was sort of, you can't do this. And they were booked, like, other criminals are booked. I think that the International Criminal Court is pretty serious. So, let me move on. So, some of the situations that they're talking about are basically setups for the kind of work that we're thinking about. So we were able to have very good conversations with the folks that work in the International Criminal Court and sort of say, would the work that we're doing in Cambodia be of interest for you in these different situations? And the basic response was yes. It would be very interesting. In fact, in some of these situations, it would be just the thing to push it from an investigation to a prosecution. And in some of the cases, they're sort of saying, no, I don't really know if that would work. Or I don't know if there's enough data, really, because the population of survivors is so small, you might not have anything. So there's really different conversations that happened over there. But the general consensus was, yeah, this should be thought about at the United Nations level. So the other thing that's really interesting about this is that the process that I had to undergo to do the work in Cambodia took me years and years, right? This experience that I had here with refugees and then many, many trips back and forth to Cambodia. But if you think about the idea of using the epidemiology as evidence, you really don't need to go anywhere but the library, right? For instance, in the international, in the Tribunal for Former Yugoslavia, The attorneys there did not know that there's already huge amount of data on the mental health pathology of Bosnians and survivors of the from Bosnia. They just didn't know it. I said it's not even data we need to harvest. It's already been harvested, and it could be impressive to the judge. And they said, really? That sounds great, right? Another one was for some of the African countries that were being considered. I mean, one of the conversations that came up is, well, look, you know, there might not be excellent data in one of these situations. Central African Republic, for instance, there might just not be excellent data on what happened to women who were raped there, right? But testimony or a report from a mental health professional that can basically say that the outcomes of gang rape that are politically motivated tend to be very bad might actually be useful in criminal court. So you sort of see the closer you can get to actually tying that crime to an outcome, the better. Like in Cambodia, where we can say the crime caused this. But still, there's some utility of this concept even when you can't exactly tie the crime to a specific thing. In other words, I might not have any data on Kenyan survivors, but if you can show that that there is a clear relationship between the risk that they're put at and outcomes in general, that can be used in the prosecution of these cases still. So what's the utility? So there's different parts of the process that the International Criminal Court and other tribunals were sort of interested in talking to me about, right? And so I think I started this lecture by telling you that I was working with the Documentation Center. I mean, I think it's right to say that the documentation of war crimes involves a look at the psychology of the victims. And I'm not saying that just because I'm a psychiatrist. I'm saying that because I think it's a huge thing that's basically been not well documented when people are able to document well the history of war crimes. In fact, at the Holocaust Museum, I was speaking to some of the folks that work at the Holocaust Museum, and some of the best studies that were originally done on the outcomes of trauma and violence on human psychology are done on that very same population and are not well depicted in the Holocaust Museum, right? And my question was, well, why not? Why don't we have some of that data available right here, right? Because that is part of the living history of these projects. So I think that the psychiatry part, the epidemiology, is part of the documentation of war crimes in general. And there are lots of centers that are documenting war crimes around the world. But specifically for the folks that are considering the prosecution of these crimes. When they think about the investigation stage, one of the things that they're thinking about is the scope. So is this a local crime, or is it in fact something that should be considered by the International Criminal Court and the United Nations. One of the ideas that the prosecutor's office there and the investigators had was, well, mental health statistics can help us with that. Somebody before this was asking about Syria, right? And you know, if we look at the mental health statistics of refugees coming out of Syria, you can demonstrate that people are very significantly affected by what's happening there. Is that the only thing? Well, I mean, you're not going to win a court case based solely on that, but that is maybe a tipping point to sort of say, look, this is bigger than a small thing. This is not a local incident. This is something of international attention. Another very interesting conversation I had was sort of defining this, the kinds of prosecution that happen in the international criminal level. The crime of terrorism was one that was being thought about in the tribunal for Lebanon. And the prosecutors were basically saying to me that it's really not been defined, but if you think about it, terror involves human psychology. And so in order to really demonstrate that someone has performed an act of terror, we have to have an outcome or an intended outcome of a psychological target. Those weren't my words, those were the prosecutor's words, so I thought that was very interesting. And then in the prosecution, we've already sort of seen a model for how that kind of works with the Cambodia work. So in other words, basically in the description of the outcomes of the alleged crimes during the prosecution, I think this epidemiology is very good evidence for the prosecutor's office. But then particularly in the part on damages and when they're thinking about sentencing, the difference between convicting somebody of specific incidences, like assigning soldiers to rape women, and demonstrating that they allowed those orders, and then also showing what happens to those women after those orders are carried out. The weight of that for the judges is tremendous. And can be the difference between a smaller sentence and a larger sentence, which is good for the prosecuting office. It's called aggravated sentencing. And then again, with what we've seen with the Cambodia case in the reparations after the court, right? It was a huge triumph to see money awarded, basically, to programs that can provide access for mental health. And so how would that work for folks that are testifying in The Hague, but who really live, you know, in a different country, right? Well, there's mechanisms actually in place, but you would have to have them as formal parts of the court process. But the International Criminal Court really thought that that was one of the easiest parts, was getting the reparations to people. In other words, cash money to go get mental health services back in their own country, or get services while they're in the process of going through a tribunal process. So, I'm getting close to 8 o'clock, and so I'll try to wrap up in a few minutes here. And I really think that some of the exciting stuff just came out, right? I mean, my work in Europe was this summer. We have been invited by the International Criminal Court to actually start participating by doing, basically providing them reports on specific situations. So that's an evolving process, but that's starting to happen now. The progress that happened last month in Cambodia was tremendous. I was beside myself, because one of the things that had happened is I went to The Hague before Cambodia was finished. And they said, well, does it work? And I said, I don't know. You know, we have to wait until we have a judgment there. And boy, it works. So I think it's a huge step in the advance of human rights, right? For the folks that I work with here, to know about that happening back in their home country is fantastic. I think it's also a big step in positive direction for all of survivors who still think about the criminal justice system, and also a potentially huge step in reconciliation for people that have lived through these kinds of things. So let me just return to our local celebrity. So the illustrations show her teaching little girls how to dance. So she taught them how to move their hands. She taught them where to put their feet. She even taught them how to tilt their heads. So Sophie actually in addition to being a mental health specialist and working at the clinic here in San Jose, she created a dance school here in San Jose and brought the tradition of Khmer dance back to California for a population that had basically not known it. She works through my program, through the First Five, Santa Clara First Five program, and still teaches dance today. This is her at New Year's with her dance troupe. The book, How Sophonie Saved the Dance, will be available in May. This was really an infomercial for a children's book. It says, the dance gave the girls energy. The dance gave Sophonie energy too. Watching the girls, Sophonie smiled. Now the shadows are gone. Now there is dance again. Christy Hale, Palo Alto illustrator, did all the illustrations for the book. I'll end with that. I think she's got one first.
In one of your earlier slides, you mentioned retelling the story.
Yeah.
When it's a recounting of a story that's a couple decades old, in what ways are you looking at them refashioning the story for their healing? Can you give some examples?
Well, I think what I would first start with is that in the work that I do, I'm usually not asking them their story. When I was a very junior in doing this work, I used to sort of try to get a complete trauma story from folks. And I found what I was doing is sort of re-traumatizing people, I mean, making them tell a story that they really didn't need to tell yet again. And specifically, I would say with regard to sexual violence, you know, there's just no reason for that to come up again necessarily in the context of an assessment or in the context of a medication visit. So I've really completely, in my own practice, I basically really work with people around how are we doing now? What kinds of symptoms are you dealing with that I can treat with medicine? So that's in the context of treatment. In the context of assessment or asylum cases, we actually have to have all of that information usually. So that is often not even done by me. It's often done by the person who's going to later do psychotherapy with a patient. So I work with a colleague who's a psychologist, and he will actually do asylum testimony. Now remember, I'm not talking about, your question I think is more about old trauma. I'm talking a little bit more about recent trauma or people that are newer immigrants, refugees. But usually I'll have the psychologist will take a more complete and comprehensive history, and I'll read it so that I know what we're dealing with. But I don't necessarily have to bring that up in a patient visit. I think your question is more, you know, how do you restructure a trauma that is 30 years old and has been played over and over and maybe even played in different ways or is now almost an impossible memory to get back to the original, in its original form. So one of the methods in doing psychotherapy for PTSD is to sort of restructure those memories or go back to them and revisit them. And maybe you're not even getting, you know, 100% of a clear memory when you're getting a memory that's been reconsidered over the last 30 years. But what often you're doing is identifying the idea that when people experienced the traumatic event, they were out of control. They had no locus for control of what happened to them, and now they sort of do. And so you're revisiting that almost like as an exposure experience and teaching somebody that you can have these memories come back to you without having tremendous anxiety, without having panic attacks, without having these other things. So that's really sort of what's meant a lot by in the testimonial therapies that they're doing in the court. I think there's a question in front. Yeah.
On the matter of reparations, is that a case where because there are about 8 or 10 countries in which investigations are taking place, in instances if there's a funding or a finding that there really was traumatic stress and that the victims are deserving some kind of reparations, does the offending country get fined and have to pay for treatment to the people who can testify that they were mistreated? Or what is the form of reparations that you reference when you
Yeah, listen? So I think that the way that, basically, it's usually not a country that is, the country is a place where there's an investigation going on, but it's usually an individual or a situation that's actually being investigated for, you know, committing a crime. And so for instance, that individual would be standing trial for the specific crimes that he or she committed. The country of origin is usually would not be necessarily fined. It would be through, in the context of the United Nations and the International Criminal Court, we're talking probably about a victims fund that would basically be money paid for them to get psychiatric treatment, either while they're in Holland testifying or through their original country through some mechanism there. Now the reality there is that there may be no mechanism in their home country. And situation by situation, I think we're going to find completely different realities. The interesting thing about Cambodia is even though it has a totally under-resourced public mental health program, there's something there at least. There's good professionals and there's nonprofit organizations that are actually doing, you know, very evidence-based treatment for mental health. But in some of the countries that were up there, mental health might not even be an option, even if there was funding for it. So I think situation by situation, the reparations would look very different. That's right. That's right. So that would be, the acknowledgement of the insult and then also treatment for it as reparations. The standard for reparations in the past, in criminal cases that have come before, was usually something like a memorial. And that's happened in Cambodia also. They're going to build a memorial, or I think they're even going to have a sort of a national day of remembrance that's on the calendar every year. You know, these maybe more symbolic things are, I think, very good ideas and should be reparations in these cases, but the very practical nature of having something is also wonderful. I think your question is, well, how do we get that in some of these places where it really doesn't exist? And we're going to pioneer that next. We'll figure that out. I think some of the situations don't lend to it and others do. Yeah.
If you have a neighbor who is Cambodian or Vietnamese or Laotian or whatever, how do you approach them and say, I see this or I see symptoms of it in your makeup? How do you get them to go and where do you send them? I mean, where are the contacts to help them?
Yeah, I mean, so I don't know if you actually have a neighbor, I'm not sure how I would approach that individual, but folks that are from a country that is conflict-oriented may or may not have themselves been through something. And so it's hard to say. I mean, basically, most of the Cambodian refugees came through a circumstance where you can predict that they will have had something have happened to them. But that's not necessarily true of all immigrant groups. But I mean, and obviously I have a bias because you can imagine who comes through, you know, my office door. But if we see people that are from post-conflict nations, I mean, the fact is that they were probably at risk for having had something happen to them. And depending on, you know, where they are in their immigration status and what kinds of insurance they have, frankly, that would be a big determinant in what kinds of treatment they're able to get in terms of mental health. Another big issue is, you know, there's a big stigma around mental health in general, and some people, even if they've been through a lot of things and are having a lot of the symptoms that I call PTSD, yeah, they're really not comfortable seeking treatment from a psychiatrist. Again, the folks that I see in the Center for Survivors of Torture, I mean, yeah, these are people that have very bad symptoms. They've been identified through refugee clinics as having mental health symptoms, so they're sort of almost cherry-picked to be in my office. Right, and so if you have a neighbor that you worry about, you know, I mean, maybe just having a frank conversation that you saw a lecture about it and saying, I don't know, but you know, maybe something available to you that would be helpful. I'm not sure how you'd approach that. Sure. Well, so two different questions. One, I don't know that I can answer. So do perpetrators feel a sense of shame? Do perpetrators ever get rehabilitation? So the folks that are actually standing trial are sort of at the top of a decision-making chain that you would consider perpetrators, right? So many, for instance, in the Cambodian genocide, many Khmer Rouge soldiers actually ended up escaping Cambodia into refugee camps and coming over to the United States as refugees. And you know, the fact of the matter is that they may or may not have been part of the Khmer Rouge soldiers squad, or even part of a terror squad. But you can imagine there's a pretty broad spectrum between someone who was accidentally a soldier fighting on a side that ended up being the wrong side, versus someone who was really a cruel planner and perpetrator, right? So there's a lot of folks that have come over here in these big refugee movements that, you know, you'd probably sort of consider them part of the perpetrating force, but really, in my mind, basically have PTSD like everybody else because they were in war and seeing this violence happen all around them. I think your question is more about the mind of someone that could be a torturer or, you know, actually orchestrate these kinds of things. And I think I might not be the right person to answer that question because I have probably some pretty strong biases. My experience is they don't tend to get treatment, and you know, in the Khmer Rouge tribunal, they're quite adamant that they had really done nothing wrong, and only at the end of it they sort of offered a very hollow written apology that was not considered very sincere. It's read. Other questions?
Other questions?
Yeah, behind you.
Without going too far off topic, we have a local organization here that deals with PTSD, a grassroots organization in Gilroy. And if anybody is interested in learning about that, please see me after this. I apologize for
going off topic. Any here. Program that's working with PTSD, can plug it.
I have my shirt here, Ameriism, Every Day is a Learning Opportunity. And our founder was a CNN Hero of the Year, Top 10 Award winner 2 years ago. Yeah. So she's doing some very good work, and I just want to show the flag.
All right.
I'd like to just add this amazing organization. I was introduced to it.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just want to
comment. Yeah, go ahead. It's please.
I was introduced to that organization, and they're doing such amazing work. So that's wonderful.
Is it specifically a mental health organization?
With your permission.
Yeah, go ahead.
Operation Freedom Pause makes, can you all hear me?
I can hear you, but I think for the recording, you want to use the mic.
Operation Freedom Pause takes shelter and rescue dogs, mates them with primarily veterans with PTSD. Also, we work with civilians with mobility and various issues, and trains them up as a service dog team. This is a very different model from most of them that train up the service dogs, and there are waiting lists of years and years, and costs in tens of thousands of dollars, whereas our program is no cost to the veterans. And right now our waiting list, because of the publicity from the CNN thing, it's out. I saw Mary reviewing applications from May, so we have a 4-month waiting list instead of a several year waiting list. So if you or any of your loved ones need help, I have some cards and some information.
All right,
thank
great.
You very much.
Thank you. Let's take a few more questions. Anybody else? Yeah.
I wanted to ask about, most recently I've read about sort of an addition to PTSD or some of the latest research that's come out about complex PTSD or see PTSD. And I'm wondering if you have any experience with that, you know, where it's not just one incident, but that it's a recurrent experience of trauma, and kind of how that differs in terms of the treatment or interventions.
So the idea of complex PTSD was championed a long time ago, and so kind of found its way into the DSM-5, not probably in the way, in as articulate a way as it should have probably. In DSM-4, it's really not there. So DSM is an evolving manual for psychiatry where we sort of try to change our research criterion so that we can more effectively study the mental health disease states with each evolution of that manual. Complex PTSD is basically what you said. When you sort of think about PTSD, and back, if you can remember that slide, I won't go back to it right now, but you know, where you have a criterion A, that can be a single event. There was some good research done on 9/11, where they looked at basically the police and the first responders and the development of PTSD, and it's sort of like a thought about as a single event, where it's basically the in Manhattan, the Twin Towers coming down on 9/11, and then did the people go on to develop PTSD? That would be not complex PTSD, or sort of more straightforward, whereas complex PTSD would be where people have multiple hits of traumatic experiences throughout their life, and probably really what we're talking about is where they have childhood traumatic events happen to them, which might shape the way they view trauma later in life. So I think your question was more about the treatment mechanism for that. I think probably what people have written most about with regard to complex PTSD is people who have gone on to develop either personality disorders or issues like domestic violence, where it's sort of a circular violent experience that's happening in time. I'd say the work that I do is not very similar to that. I think the work that I do is usually more like the standard version of PTSD, where people have a pretty straightforward and non-traumatic development, and then have some specific event happen to them. Specifically at CST, that would be that they're persecuted for some usually political reason, sometimes not clear reason, maybe because of the color of their skin or their ethnic background. And then they have a torture event that happens to them, and then after that they've developed PTSD. So most of the work that I'm doing is with non-complex. I say complex PTSD. Most of the data that's out there would suggest that psychotherapy is an important part of it. If you're asking about specifically psychiatry and the use of medication, there's probably a role for medication to treat symptoms. I'm of the school of philosophy that psychotropic medications can be quite useful, but they're usually not curative. So specifically for complex PTSD, I would never say, well, here's some Zoloft. I think you're just gonna be fine. But at the same time, Zoloft can be very, very helpful. So from my perspective, if I saw somebody and made that diagnosis, I'd probably be talking with them about a medication option, but probably emphasizing, it's really important for you to be involved in some kind of psychotherapy.
From a preparatory, from the people that are committing these genocides, do they have specific orders of what to do, like so many people to kill a day or whatever? Or is it something that they just kind of come up with themselves on the fly?
On the fly. Well, I'm not sure how to answer that question. I mean, there are a number of different specific genocides that occurred in the last century. Each one had maybe a different sort of characteristic about it. And so there's an interesting book it's a very heavy book, I don't necessarily recommend it, but basically about genocide and answering the question, are there themes that occur from one to the next? And even the author of that book wrote about four cases of genocide in the last century, and even he said, they're similar in some ways, and I can make some generalizations, but they're very, very different. And then he went on to say, I did not include Rwanda in this book because I don't even know what happened there. the author was an expert on genocide, and he said, I can't explain what happened there, because it seemed to defy what I know about genocide. So I guess in some instances there's patterns. Some of the genocides that have occurred in the last one century have been more structured and ordered than others. I would say I'm probably most expert on the Cambodian genocide because I've been involved in the criminal justice process and observed the evidence that's come out. And it seems that was a pretty structured and very violent version of genocide. Also, the motives for genocide can be quite different from one place to another. A thing that's quite different about what happened in Cambodia was not a racial or religious or ethnic version of genocide. It was really a class genocide, where the Khmer Rouge were basically trying to eliminate anyone who represented participation in or knowledge of the former culture and regime. It's one of the reasons why this book was important for me to get out there, and why Sophonie's story is really important. The thing I didn't say in this lecture is one of the reasons why she was targeted for execution is because she was a dance teacher. And since she was a dance teacher, they found that very dangerous. Well, why would a dance teacher be very dangerous? Well, it's because it's a piece of the old culture that they wanted to eliminate. They didn't want any artists or dancers. The first people executed were the monks. Right? So each of these different examples has a different motive and therefore often a different sort of consequence. I hope that answers that question. Yeah, I don't know. There's a couple.
Do you have another question?
No. What's the name of the book?
Oh, the book is called How Sophonie Saved the Dance.
The one that you not
recommend. Oh, that book, I think it's called I think the book, if I'm not I'm going to say it wrong. I think it's called A Century of Genocide. He gave four examples in that book, but tried to generalize. Yeah.
How would you approach if, for example, you have an ongoing trauma and then you have people who are currently being traumatized by current events? How would the approach be different as opposed to past trauma?
Yeah, so I'm not sure what you're thinking about in terms of example, but I mean, really, you know, there's not going to be a very effective intervention until there's some perception of safety. So, for instance, with the people that we are working with at the Center for Survivors of Torture, many of them are new immigrants, new refugees, and their psychosocial situation is very unstructured. They're having a hard time finding housing. They're poorly acculturated. And so their level of stress is really, you know, a really important factor. And so, you know, some of the more important clinicians that I work with are the social workers who are basically getting them housing. Right? I mean, really, some of the questions have been around psychotherapy for survivors. And you know, when I say they're not ready for it, I mean, sometimes I mean they're not ready for it because they basically don't have a stable home life. They don't know how they're going to pay rent if they're even lucky enough to be in a place where they have a lease. Right? So, you know, basically getting somebody into a place where they have real safety and then also making sure that they have the perception of safety. Those are two different things, but obviously related. Now, one of the more difficult things to deal with is somebody who has an ongoing traumatic stressor, like somebody in a domestic violence relationship where they're still in it and they're coming for treatment. You know, really try to be clear that the symptoms aren't likely to go away until you're actually able to resolve the stressor. We can treat, you can give somebody medication, but it's just not likely to be helpful.
I was thinking along the lines of, for example, in an ongoing war in Syria, for example, if possibly safe spaces, because safe spaces are being created in terms of support, do you think that would be helpful in situations like
that? I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last thing you said.
So safe spaces in Syria, inside the war, they're creating safe spaces and support groups. Like, so, for example, right now we're in a safe space.
Yeah, I see what you're saying, yeah.
Yeah, like safe havens, sort of.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's better, right? But there has to be real safety and then also the perception that it is, in fact, safe. And then also, I think the perception of lasting safety also has to be, you know, is an important factor in people getting well. You know, one of the ways that you can predict outcomes for PTSD also is exactly what you're sort of asking about. So given, you know, why is it that given a particular traumatic event, you know, some people would go on to develop a syndrome and other people would not, right? A lot of the times, it's the other risk factors that are very important. You know, a lot of people who have criterion A for PTSD, in fact, most people who meet that criterion do not, in fact, go on to develop the syndrome that we call PTSD. That's not to say that they're not affected by what happened to them or that the trauma doesn't bother them. But some of the very risk factors that would push somebody toward the development of that diagnostic category are the things you're talking about, right? Sort of if they have the perception that they're still unsafe or the reality is that they're still unsafe, if they're still witnessing violence, you know, they're really, the risk factor for them to actually get pushed over that edge is ever present. I mean, Syria is a very good example of a place that's probably applicable for this idea of using epidemiology in a criminal process.
I came here to listen about resilience, and I forgot that. Can you talk about resilience, how people have able to...
Yeah, resilience, yeah. Well, I'm sorry if that was in the title of my talk and I didn't spend as much time on that. I mean, that really is the anchor to all of the work that we're doing, is the idea that people can get better and that treatment can move them toward the direction of getting better. So resilience can be thought about in two different ways, I think. One way is, so what are the protective factors that keep people from going on to developing mental health symptoms, right? That's one idea of what resilience means. And I mean, another idea of what resilience means is somebody who actually goes on and has terrible things happen to them and develops some symptoms and then is able to heal. That's another idea of what resilience means, is sort of being able to bounce back. I mean, the latter of those two ideas is really the driving force for all of the work that we do clinically is basically, you know, promoting the resilience that's already intrinsic to a person and giving them, breaking down all the risk factors for having bad outcomes and promoting all of these protective factors for good outcomes. I hope that was a sufficient answer. I think you're asking a question that's really a much bigger answer than I can give right now.
Well, I mean, for example, this meditation.
If
these patients are practicing meditations, does that ultimately help them deal with these situations better, or is it?
Yeah. So there's case examples in that experience where we've seen patients who basically did the meditation group and took it very seriously and did it over the course of many months and even years, and then would come into me and say, you know, I'd like to get a trial without the medicine now, because I think I'm doing better. And, you know, from my perspective, I'm like, really? Like, wow, let's see if that works. I've had a few patients in the Cambodian program who've actually, you know, ultimately felt like they were in a resolved enough place that they didn't need our program support anymore, and they didn't need psychiatric treatment anymore. And, you know, I'm not sure what we call it, if that's resilience, but watching people go from being very, very unwell to being very well is very satisfying. Let's say, I think, do we have to end at, do you want to do one more, or do you want to?
Does anyone else have a closing question?
Right, and it's a very good point. And if you noticed during my lecture today, I took a page out because it was really, unfortunately, it was the page that kind of answered the question and addressed exactly what she's saying. And that page doesn't go in the criminal court, because talking about how people can grow from these experiences is not what the prosecutor needs. But you know, it is an important point. And I did try to make the point in this lecture that PTSD is one kind of outcome that people can have. And even if people do at some point meet the criterion for that diagnosis, it doesn't mark them forever. It doesn't define them. It really is just something that we can use as a calibration. It's really basically what PTSD is the thing that psychiatrists use as a way to research how to treat symptoms of traumatic stress. And it's not the most fantastic one, because there's other ways that people deal with trauma. And that's more along the lines of a resilience talk, which is maybe I'll come back in 6 months with the resilience talk. Maybe we should end with that, because I don't want to go past people's time. Thank you.
For more, please visit us at stanford.edu.